It's gonna be May. Oh, yes. Hi, I'm Chanel. I'm a student studying physics in the Los Angeles area and a soon-to-be college graduate. And this is the Piper Nell podcast, my space where I get to talk about knitting, mostly as a way to cope with growing up and changing in scary ways. So today is Tuesday, May 3rd. This episode is late. Last, I usually record on Wednesdays and upload went that same night or the Thursday morning afterwards, but school's been totally crazy. Yeah, this is almost a week late. But I did mention that this is a knitting podcast, so let's get right into things. This first finished object, we're gonna start off with finished objects, is kind of unconventional. It's a collection of similar objects, and I talk about my course load sometimes on this podcast, and one of the courses I am taking this semester is a Shakespeare course, which is a literature course, where we do read five Shakespeare plays, but then we choose one to produce as a final project, like full performance. We act, we direct, we decide on sound effects, costumes, special effects, or whatever, what have you, everything, staging. And this year the performance was outdoors, so it's always outdoors, so we don't get lighting or anything. Anyway, so we put on a production of King Lear, which is a pretty ambitious play for a troupe of amateurs who are tech students who don't really have much acting experience. We decided on a post-apocalyptic setting for the play, and I will talk more about this later. But anyway, this was my contribution to costuming. Since we were going for a post-apocalyptic setting, that was particularly in a desert, so we had this visual motif of water being an important source of power for the characters. So the noble characters in the play would carry would vis have would visibly have canteens of water on them, and we had a bunch of metal water bottles, because those are pretty common things to find at a career fair, say, and we get a lot of them for free. But that doesn't look great, hanging off someone's belt. Plus, not everyone had like a carabiner or something to hook it onto a belt loop. However, a lot of the characters did have belts as part of their costume, so I knitted a bunch of these pouches. And this is just Red Heart Super Saver. It's like the super huge skein. Is it the 1 pound one? Yeah. Wow, I feel so out of practice. It's like a week later. So out of practice. Yeah, so there's some debris because they've already been through our two performances. And there's actually a spot of fake blood here. Woo! So what I did with these was, well, I really improvised the design. We had a big costuming group meeting, and as everyone else was working out the say like what pants and shirts for people to wear, we had decided pretty early on that these canteen holders were going to be important to the look. So I sat down with the skein that we bought from Walmart and started to try to come up with a simple design for them that I could repeat over and over. I think I made about six or seven of them. All of the ones that I grabbed and I have right here are knit in slightly different methods, because it really was a trial and error process, and it's a pretty forgiving little thing because it's really stretchy. This mesh is a knit two together yarn over mesh. The way I started a pouch, I played around with a few different methods. One, there's some debris falling out on my desk. I'm gonna have to clean it later. Great. So I tried a couple of different methods. I tried a Judy's magic cast on so I could start off knitting it around. That didn't really work. Or well, it did. I think this one is the Judy's magic cast on one. I did it wrong. And the cast on stitches are pretty loose. But that gave me a nice base to work it around on, and then I would knit the mesh. For most of them, I believe what I did is I would just cast on normally. I think I did the backwards loop cast on just for quickness. I knit a couple rows in garter stitch, and then I would just pick up stitches along the side and start knitting in around from there. This one, I think, yeah, this one must have been the first one I knit because this mesh is different from the rest of them. It's still knit two together, yarn over, but on the alternate rows, instead of knitting all the stitches, I purled all the stitches because I guess I wanted a garter-based mesh. However, that was more time-consuming because I do knit stitches faster than I do purl stitches. So anyway, I would knit them. So yes, I have all three here. Sorry if I'm playing around with them a lot and it's being distracting. I'm so sorry. Anyway, okay. So once I would cast on in something that I would manage to end up knitting around, and it ends up doing this cool spiral effect because yarn overs. The knit two togethers, lean stitches all lean to one side and start spiraling up. And once I knit something long enough, then I bound off most of the stitches, just a normal bind off, but pretty loosely so the mouth could stretch. And all except for a couple of stitches. I think I left about four. From there, I would actually cast on using a short tail cast on again. So a backwards loop or a cable cast on, so I could get this length. This is tied right now, so I would cast on many stitches. So I and then knit a couple rows back and forth on all of those stitches, so I get the strap. Then I bind off all of the stitches, and then I end up with some ends that I ended up tying together with tassels. Wow, I said end a lot there. I'm sorry. All right, so once that is a function, so that makes a functional object, and what you do with the strap is, since a lot of the characters have belts, you run the strap under the belt, over the belt, and then stick it through one of the mesh holes, like this, and then tie it up. They're pretty sturdy. Yeah, Red Heart Super Saver is all acrylic, so these are will last till the end of time. And right after I'm done recording this, I'm gonna go put them back in the prop closet for storage. We have a storage closet that's this class has been running for a while, so over the years it's accumulated a lot of props. It's probably the weirdest room on campus. Anyway, so that's my first finished objects. Second finished object has not been on the podcast for a while. I hope showing it goes better than last time, but we'll see. Okay, getting out of my chair now. You see this? You see this? All right, I'm gonna stand back and try to open it up. Ha. So this is the community spiral blanket, which I've not talked about since the second episode. But the pattern is 10 Stitch Twist by Frankie Brown, and it's the circular version of her 10 Stitch blanket, which is a rectangular blanket built up through mitered corners, going around and around. This one use the same principle, short rows create curves, but you start off with this central circle, and then this is the beginning of the spiral, so you increase until you get to 10 stitches, And then you just go around and around, switching colors whenever. Oh, this is the wrong side. Well, there's no wrong or right side to this blanket, but this is the wrong side of garter stitch. I'm gonna flip it around. Yeah, I've gotten so much better at showing things. All right, so knit around and around. You switch colors whenever. Do have to weave in ends. So I did prefer longer color sections. However, on these last couple of rounds, I had a lot of scrap yarn to use up. So there are a lot of little segments of color. And these yarns are from all over the place. Most of them are from a suitcase of yarn that one of my friends brought to school because his grandma passed away, but she was an avid knitter, so she had a lot of stash. So there are various vintage yarns. A lot of them are acrylic or acrylic blends. There are some probably have wool in them. This one feels like a cottony blend. Some I contributed for my own. This is a scrap of woolies. This dark red is also woolies. And then the yarns were also of various weights. So if they'll say a fingering-ish weight yarn, I would actually chain ply it like you do in spinning, but since you're not spinning, it doesn't ply onto itself. It's just like you're holding a yarn triple stranded. See, if it was a sport, like a heavy sport or DK weight, I would double ply it like this. I would hold it double stranded like this pink one. This yellow one is chain plied. And then if it was worsted or bulky weight, I would just knit it normally. It's a really forgiving pattern for gauge. You see that some of the stripes are knit more narrow than others, some are wider and bulkier, some are even thicker. This one is a really hairy yarn. I hope it holds up in the wash. But it's probably the softest segment in this blanket. So yeah, after you knit it to a satisfying size, what you do is you start decreasing. And well, that's just one option. You can always just bind off 10 stitches that you have. I wanted a nice smooth edge. So this is the final color segment, and you decrease and decrease until you're down to just one stitch, and then you tie it off, and you're done. So yeah, I mean, I'm by far not the only person that's worked on this blanket. Put it there. It is too hot to have it sitting on my blanket. I'm sorry, that was loud. It's too hot to have it sitting on my lap. Whew. Yeah, if I'm out of breath, it's because it is pretty hot outside. I've been walking around all morning, and the air conditioning is not being very effective right now. But yeah, I am not the only one that's contributed to that blanket. About five or six people have knitted a lot on that blanket. I've probably still done the most, but just starting and finishing, that was me. That was all me. So that's all my FOs. Both of them are, neither of them are, like personal things that are for me. But I, they were, well, the blanket was an ongoing project that I really needed to finish before I graduate, and the Shakespeare canteen holders were for a class, so I was kind of working on a deadline. I've been super busy and not really working on personal projects, but all of my whips are mostly for me. So, whip time. Right. First whip is a pair of socks. These are not quite vanilla socks, but I actually cast these on just for a sock along that Kina of the She's Crafty podcast is doing for April and May. And I'm like, yeah, it'd be nice to just have a group of people to talk about socks with. The pattern is Petty Harbor by Raina Curtis, which is a free pattern on Ravelry, and it's been a really fun pattern. If you can see here, it's really textured. It's all knits and purls. It's a really short repeat, so it's nice and soothing and easy to memorize, but has enough variety to keep things not boring. Not that I'm really bored when I knit stockinette socks. I just felt like, I think part of it was this yarn and how many colors it has. The yarn is Haute Knit Yarn Simple Sock, which is 80/20 merino nylon. I don't think she names her colorways, but this one has is super variegated. This is the sole here, but you have all of these splotches of pinks and greens and yellows. Also, it's a very springy color. Kina encouraged us to choose a color that reminded us of spring or Easter or the season. I guess I was a little afraid of how it would pool. Not that it ended up pooling anything I've seen before, but I was a little worried it'd actually be too busy once I knit a couple rows of the texture. But I think the texture actually brings out the variegation and plays nicely off of it. So these will be a really fun pair of socks, for me. The cuff is just 1x1 ribbing, and I always use my German twisted cast on for sock cuffs. And the heel, I actually did try something new. I think I want to try like maybe a different heel method for each pair of socks I knit for a while at least, until I find something that I really like and maybe settle on it. But I'm always for trying new techniques. So this is a German short row heel. The last pair of socks I knit, I tried the fish lips kiss heel for the first time, and this German short row heel was pretty similar. I like short row heels. I've actually never knit a conventional gusset, heel flapping gusset sock. The first sock I knit it exactly according to the pattern. It was twirl, which I forget who wrote it. I'll link it in the show notes. And that actually had a Dutch heel, so I did knit a heel flap, but I did not have really any gusset decreases at all. It was an interesting first heel to do. Anyway, so I haven't tried on the sock yet, but it feels like it should fit pretty well. So I'm on the foot now, and I'll just knit until it's long enough for my feet. I really like this yarn. It's so pretty. It makes me happy. Also, I've gotten a lot done on it lately because it's been thesis talks. And so, yesterday, 2 nights ago, I finished the heel. I just sat down and did it in one sitting because I don't know, a heel for me is not the kind of thing that I will drop in the middle of and pick back up. But all of this I did yesterday while sitting and listening to my friends give their talks about their thesis work. And I also had to give a presentation, so I was, but and I had to be in a room with them. Well, I didn't have to. I wanted to support them. Anyway, I'm really chatty today. I hope this doesn't turn out to be a super long episode. Next whip I showed last episode, and it has not made much progress, is the Piano Number 2, the pattern is by Nathan Taylor, who's the sockmatician. The two sides are so cool, and the contrast is turning out exactly the way I dreamed of. I'm knitting it with US 3 or 3.25 millimeter bamboo needles. Let's see. And the yarn I'm using is Cascade Heritage Sock. The orange is Solar, which is in the Wave color family, so Cascade Heritage Wave. And then the gray is, its name is Charcoal. Its name. It's like my pet. which is from their Solid color family. Yeah, it's been slow going because it is a pattern that takes a bit more brain power. Also just it's not a portable project because I'm not a person with a lot of project bags. Plus, I don't really want to deal with like not getting these two balls tangled up while I'm around or in lecture or something. But yeah, I mean, it's for me, so I'm not on any deadlines or anything. It's probably going to be on the needles for a while, and so hope maybe like the spiral blanket, I won't show it every episode unless I've made significant progress on it. And then the last whip I'm going to talk about is the sand and sea top that I'm knitting for a friend with using yarn that she gave me. So the pattern I'm using is the cap sleeve lattice top. I'm just calling it the sand and sea top because the colors remind me of the sand, a sandy beach, and the sea. I'm more than halfway done with it. This also does not have a lot of progress on it since last time. Last time I had just bound off to make the first half of the neck opening, and now I've and then af immediately after that you cast back on the stitches to make the other side. And I made a mistake somewhere in the lattice, but given that it's like right over the shoulder fold, I don't think it's going to show up much. And this yarn is like so nubby and textured, I think it would. No one's gonna notice. It's a really cool looking. I think it's a really cool effect. I'm a little worried because my bind off is actually stretchier or turned out to be looser than the cast on I used, which was just a cable cast on recommended by the pattern, which is by Pearl Soho. I forgot to mention that. And it's a free pattern. So this, because most tops like scoop down lower in the front than on the back, I might end up having to flip it around. The pattern tells you to knit the back first, and then after making the neck hole, then you're knitting down the front. But we'll see. So this blue yarn is a silk single that my friend gave me. She didn't have any labels for it, so but all she knows is that it's silk. And the beige tweedy yarn is some wool blend, which I found out through a burn test. And it's a really cool contrast in textures. There's actually two kinds of silk yarn here, this royal blue one and this variegated blue one that I striped in. And the way the colors just pooled really looked like ripples in water. I had a message from a viewer who she messaged me through Ravelry and gave me some good insight on this silk single because when I first the first episode that I brought this top up in, I discussed the struggle I had with knitting this yarn. It's as I mentioned before, it's silk and it's a single. And it is S spun, so the twist goes a certain way, and that I would say most yarns are S spun, but they're plied S spun, and so that means they're spun, they're Z spun in singles. So something about that I would really like to investigate that. That's really cool. Is that then when you knit a single like that, you're actually adding more twist. Usually the way, if you're wrapping in the direction most people wrap their yarns in. That's the progress on this top, which isn't much because school has been all-consuming. I am entering this top into Mina of the Knitting Expats sweater along. It's a year-long knit along that she's hosting in her group, and I asked her because I wasn't sure if a short sleeve top would count, but people are knitting vests, whatever like garments people can wear. So definitely check out that knit along. It's pretty fun, and all these people are knitting like super awesome Fairlot stranded sweaters. It's goals someday. Oh, I forgot to mention, the piano number two is also going into a knit along. The Bakery Bears are hosting a double knit along because Dan, who is one half of the Bakery Bears, recently learned how to knit, double knit from the Dark Lord of DK, Nathan. And he invited all of us to join him on his double knitting journey. So, hey Dan. All right, that's all I have for knitting stuff. I'm gonna put this away. Do-do-do. Wow, I've already been talking for 25 minutes. Oh my God. All right. Last fibery related makey thing. Wow, I can words. That I have is some spinning. So last time I was working on spinning up some thin and mohair locks that a friend sent to me really generously. And this is the result. I'm gonna hold this up here. This is I'm super proud of this. So let me unravel the skein for you. Look, it's balanced. It doesn't twist. Oh my God. Ah! Okay, silliness aside there. So, as I mentioned before, this is spun from fin, sheep wool, and mohair. Both of them came in locks. So, it was definitely a learning experience. So let me roll this up. It was definitely a learning experience. Like figuring out how to work with locks, how to kind of I pull them apart. I know some people just spin it as locks and have the locks hanging off in a really cool textural way. I did not feel comfortable enough with my skills to do that. So I pull them apart and tried to spin them as reasonably uniform singles. So I spun up one single with the fin and one single with mohair, and then ply them together. And well, the fin single is a lot finer and more uniform than the mohair single, which makes sense. I'm pretty used to working with wool by now, but mohair was an entirely different beast, literally. Goats versus sheep. So it is still pretty thick and thin, but I think the way. So when I was plying it, I let the twist travel up a lot further than I've done in the past, which I guess I've been plying too tightly, which is why my yarn hasn't been balanced. So, first balanced yarn. Yeah, I'm pretty proud. Oh, you can tell. Yeah, and that's all the things I've made, but before I move on to more chattery things, I wanted to mention some podcasts I've been watching. Even though I've been super busy, I've been procrastinating by checking out new podcasts, I guess. Good life choices. So, first one I want to mention is I want to say hi to Mars from the Brownberry Chronicles. She is in Florida and she's a mom, so sometimes she brings on her two daughters onto episodes, and it's really cool to see their interactions and how supportive she is of their own craftiness. But this is gonna sound kind of creepy, but I find her voice so soothing, and just the way she talks about her stuff. She on one of her episodes, she drew. She also does some drawing and painting, and on one of her episodes, she's participating in a knit along with Hohi Locatelli's three color cashmere shawl, which I know a lot of people are getting in on. I don't have time to really do projects like that. But she was testing out her color combination with the shawl because it does require three colors. And what she did was she drew a picture of a shawl. She referenced one of the project page pictures with someone. With someone holding the shawl spread out behind them in a field, and it's a really nice looking picture. And so she drew that and then colored the picture in with her with the color combination she thought she was going to use. And that's genius. Like, I want to do that next time I have something to do with a color combination. So so hey Mars. And then the next podcast I want to talk about is is one I've been meaning to check out for a while. I think someone commented on one of my previous episodes with like, "Hey, you'd be really interested in this person's stuff because you've similar interests." And so I want to say hi to Robin from the Stitching Between Pages podcast. She's in Chicago and she's doing a PhD in medieval literature, so nerds unite. I'm into sciences, but it's the way just hearing about someone talk about their academic interests and reading to discover more knowledge is super cool. I mean, I also and I'm kind of a history nerd. It's rubbed off on me from a couple of my friends. And she, of course, her knitting is awesome. She has great taste in colors. And she has also two adorable cats, which never hurt to for me to want to watch a podcast. And then, so, hey, Robin. The last podcast I want to talk about is Stress Knits by Stacy. And she's, like me, a college student, actually. So she broadcasts out of. Broadcasts podcasts out of her dorm room like I do, and she's an RA. She knits beautiful socks and has an enviable collection of indie yarns. So I just wanted to say, hey Stacy, I hope everything's going well with the end of the semester. I don't know what like how your schedule is, your academic calendar is, but I'm there in the end of the semester crunch. And I hope you're doing well in that and finishing up things and getting ready for graduation. So, solidarity. All right, that's all I have for fibery things. And if that's all you're here for, that's okay. It was nice having you tuning in, and I hope you have a good rest of your day. All right, my phone cut out. Sorry. So I have a viewer question from Kim in Sweden, whose Ravelry name is Awesome Wooishly, with the W capitalized in both. And she and I have been messaging back and forth about our careers in science, how that ties into what we do outside of work, like how to take care of ourselves with exercise and food and mental health. And so we got on the topic of she does gymnastics, and I mentioned that I've been taking aerial circus classes. So she asked me what aerial circus is like. And so I thought I'd share some stuff with you. I will cut in, I'm gonna take a break after I finish answering this question, and I'll cut in some circusy videos of me doing stuff. But basically, aerial circus is a combination of gymnastics and kind of aerial acrobatics. So common apparatuses that you can like go to a studio and take classes in are aerial silks, which is just two huge pieces of fabric that you wrap in various ways and climb on. And then you have aerial hoop, which is a large metal circle, and aerial trapeze, which is not the swinging trapeze that you might think of. That's a flying trapeze. This is a static trapeze, so it's just two ropes and then the bar, but then you and then the tricks you climb up on, you jump up onto the bar, you wrap the ropes in various ways and stuff. I've dabbled in all of these. I've dabbled in all three of those, and I've also I once got to play on an apparatus called Aerial Cube, which is exactly what it says on the tin. It's a giant metal cube. So it's basically a series of bars that you can hang off of. Yeah, and so I go to a local circus studio that's about a mile away from my school, and I go once a week, and a class takes lasts about 2 hours, and we do some warm-ups and we learn a few tricks. And then we also try to incorporate flowing between moves, so it's not just like, oh, you put your foot here, put your hand there, put your arm through this, and then trick. All right, now where do we go from here? It's really useful to learn how to transition between moves so you can start to, choreograph routines and perform routines. And I've learned that I really like performing and being, I guess it gives me a way to like control my own image and the way I present myself to people. So aerial circus has been like, another venue for me performing. So it's definitely helped a lot with my upper body strength, and it's also because it's so scheduled, it's great to just have that in my routine as something I bike down to, and I know it's going to be a good break from me for me. I actually skipped class recently though, so oh, I need to work it back into my routine. So yeah, I'm actually going to stop here for a bit. I hope that answered your question, Kim. Please let me know if you want to know anything more. And to everyone else, if you want to ask anything of me, like about techniques I use in knitting, something knitting related, something not knitting related, something I've briefly mentioned in the podcast but haven't talked about, personal things, I'm okay with really talking about anything. And if I'm not okay with talking about it, I will at least read your question out loud and tell you why I'm not okay with talking about it. So I actually have a meeting to go to. I've been too chatty, so I'm going to come back and record the rest of this episode later. Hey there, I'm back. I hope you enjoyed those videos with me doing aerial circus. I ended up taking a break longer than I thought I would, and it wasn't just a meeting. It's now after 4 p.m. I started, the earlier recording was about 11 a.m., so I had my meeting over lunch. And then I had to go study for a final that I just got back from taking. It was for my Women in Music course, so I think it went pretty well. Anyway, I hope you don't mind, but I'm going to be knitting on these socks for this kind of the rest of this episode, which will be mostly just me chatting about what's been going on with my life since this podcast is also an kind of a space for me to just not, I don't want to say vent. I'm not unloading on all of y'all. I am, I don't know. What am I doing? Just unpacking what I experience in my everyday life and just getting some time to think about it. So, as I've mentioned before multiple times, I've been really busy lately, and that's because it's almost the end of the semester, and there's normally an end of the semester crunch. That crunch got pushed up because I am a graduating senior and I need to get in all my grades early so they can come in before the graduation ceremony. So, I mean, I'm pretty sure I will graduate unless something goes terribly wrong, which you never know. Might always happen. So, part of my life lately has actually been a surprising amount of performances. 2 weekends ago was, no, 3 weekends ago now was my last orchestra concert, and we played the Brahms Requiem, which is notable because it's a requiem that's in German, not the usual Latin, because Brahms wanted to compose a German requiem. It's like, oh, we're German. Oh, yeah. And so that was a joint performance between the orchestra and the choir. And that's always cool having extra people on stage with you and just having, like, seeing new faces. And the choir just adds so much to the piece. Also, orchestral accompaniments to choir pieces generally aren't very exciting. Plus, I have some friends in the choir, so it's like, yeah, we get to see each other in rehearsal. So, Pearl. Pearl. Yes, that's it. Yeah, and it was also surreal being in that it was my last orchestra concert. I've been in the orchestra at Pomona College for all 8 semesters I've been in college. And for our last concert, since we're graduating seniors, they give all of us little rose boutonnieres to pin on our clothes. And I mean, I've been friends with several seniors like in the past, so I would see them have the roses on their chests, and then they would be, and then at the beginning of the concert, the conductor would read off all of the names of graduating seniors, and they'd stand up, and then everyone would applaud for them, and I could just never see myself in that position until I was in that position, and I don't, I was, it's just so weird. And then we always give 2 concerts, so one's on Friday, one's on Sunday. And at the end of the Sunday concert, right after the piece ends, I just was like, oh my God, that's the last note I'm going to be playing in this space ever. And oh, that's such a weird way to put it. Yeah, and I've been telling my friends and that I don't know, the end of senior year, or I guess this is probably true for a lot of like when you're like, transitioning out of some stage of your life, that you're collecting lasts instead of firsts, and that's scary, and oh my God. Yeah. So, another performance I had was the Shakespeare performances, which I've mentioned. We also give 2 of those. One was this past Friday, one was this past Saturday. Totally ate up my time this weekend. And I actually had to get an extension on my thesis, like final report, because I was just too busy with the performances all afternoon to get it in at 5 p.m. on Friday. Which was really nice of the department to do that for us. And I think it went pretty well. Like I mentioned at the beginning of this episode. So, this play is the final project for a literature course I'm taking on Shakespeare. And we choose one of the 5 plays we read to put on a full production. And so we chose King Lear because it was exciting, has lots of drama, lots of character depth. And if you're curious, my character was the Earl of Kent, who's I'm really sorry if you're have studied Shakespeare more extensively than me, and I'm totally butchering things. But the way I put my character, the Earl of Kent, or Kent for short, is the guy who tries to keep everything together and tries the hardest. And I mean, ultimately, everyone gets screwed over in the play, so maybe that failure hits Kent the hardest. I don't know. But yeah, that was a way I was describing the play to people, not just my friends exactly. So I would say if I've ever let you down in a group project, or anyone in this class has ever let you down, come to the Shakespeare play and watch us, act sad and get screwed over as our characters. Yeah. And then, oh, I actually have one more performance. So my school does something called Wednesday Nighters, which are on Wednesday nights in one of the main like student, I don't want to say like student union buildings. It's a student living room that's also where our mail room and like major study areas are, and also where the dean of like the dean of students' office is. So it's really like a hub for student activities. And so every Wednesday night at 10:30, they bring in free donuts for people who come to the performance and a student performer. I've always wanted to do a Wednesday nighter performance since I was a first year student, and I don't really have any performable skills. I mean, I play violin, I can kind of sing, but I can't accompany myself on piano or guitar or anything. Regardless, I signed up for one at the beginning of the semester thinking that maybe I'd have time to maybe just pick up a few chords on the guitar. Nope, did not happen. But I ended up singing some songs I really like by the artist, an artist named Mitski, who's a really cool female punk artist, and a band called AJJ. They're formerly known as Andrew Jackson Jihad, when I think the best way to describe them is folk punk. So punk. So punk music and some I wannabe poems that I've read. My friends liked it. I think it's the kind of performance that would really only stand at Mud in this setting, in a college setting where a lot of people have had similar experiences or feelings. Because the theme of my performance was kind of like angsting about college, basically, and like the challenges I faced, expressed through song and dance, not dance, just spoken word. So yeah, I gave a Wednesday nighter, got free donuts. I think that's all the performances I had. I guess my thesis talk kind of counts as a performance. That was yesterday. And oh man, I am so glad to be done with that. We submitted our report last night, and if you follow me on Instagram, then you might have seen a picture of the samples that we used for our research project. For my physics research project, we're basically studying magnetic properties of like two different samples that Los Alamos National Laboratories, which is a laboratory facility in New Mexico, send us samples and we characterize them and just take data on funky things that happen with the samples and so on. I would probably bore you if I go into more detail, and I honestly don't know how much is appropriate to talk about in a research project in public. I don't know. Yeah, like I said, I'm a physics noob. Just powering through the rest of the semester and almost there. Just almost there. I got back from my final exam. That's the only final I'll have to take for the semester, and then I have two papers to do. I unfortunately just found out that one of those papers is due tomorrow night, not Thursday night. Okay, let's do it. So yeah, that's my life right now. But I guess, I do have an announcement. So I've talked about my struggles with figuring out my plans for after graduation. And kind of the stress that came with that, and that it was really feeding my, insecurities about myself and my career plans. So I have made a decision about where I'll be after graduation, and I can't say too many details, because the organization who is sponsoring this wants me to wait, until their, like, official press release before I make, like, I name the thing on social media. And this podcast certainly counts as a public venue. It's open to the entire internet, not just like my Facebook friends. They won't even allow me to post on Facebook. Well, yeah. Anyways, long story short, I'm going to be moving to New Jersey in a month. Yeah. Oh, yeah, wow, crap. So I will be working on a master's in education in at Montclair State University, which I'm told is in the Newark area. Clearly have not done my research yet, but it's a teaching fellowship, so they're paying for my master's, and then in exchange, I'm going to be teaching in the New Jersey area for a while. So I don't know too many people in the area. I have a few friends who are going to get jobs in New York after graduation, so I'll be able to keep in touch with them. But if you're in the area, please feel free to contact me, and I'd love to get to know you and the area. If you could tell me anything about what it's like to live there. I must sound horribly naive committing to an area that I don't know what it's like to live there, but you know what? I'm still young. I can do it. I can do it. I'll figure things out. I'm pretty sure I have at least that in me. So yeah, that's I guess the last life update I have that I want to share. Next is the on my radar section, and as you might have guessed, with all of this school stuff, I haven't been, really reading or watching anything new. And in fact, what I want to talk about is what I've been listening to while I work. And actually, that's been a lot of video game soundtracks, a lot of indie games, some like, big franchise games like The Last of Us, which is a great, like, plot-driven post-apocalyptic action game, which also we used as the soundtrack or just incidental music pre-show and during intermission and during bows for our post-apocalyptic production of King Lear. So that it's a really great bare minimal soundtrack, and I really need something to be playing in the background while I'm working. So there's The Last of Us. A lot of them are also from indie games like FTL, Faster Than Light, which is a great, like, spaceship simulator. I've actually played that. Journey has a beautiful soundtrack, great atmosphere. I think sometimes it's a little too intense for me to actually work. I need kind of ambient percussive music, but it's exciting. If I really like need to get pumped up, it works for me. And Journey, of course, is a great, like, artsy conceptual game. And then another one I've been listening to a lot is from a game called There Came an Echo. I haven't played this game, but now I want to because the soundtrack is so good. But yeah, so I've been listening to video game soundtracks also because I think it because they're entire soundtracks to a piece, it all sounds cohesive, and it's about an hour. It's going to be like an hour or two of music that's not interrupted by any, like, mood changes or just atmosphere changes. So it's really good for, like, working for a couple hours at a time and then break, and maybe I can switch to something else. So yeah, which kind of leads me to a question I have for you. So, like, what do you do to get into your productivity zone? I'm definitely not the greatest at being productive. I've found ways that help me with, like, to-do lists and stuff. If you listen to music, what do you listen to? So I'd really be interested in hearing everyone's answers. So if you want to, you can comment in the YouTube comments, or you can hop over to the Ravelry group, which I forgot to mention at the beginning of the episode because I am so scatterbrained right now, and post in the episode thread, which will also have the show notes. So yeah, please tell me. And that's really all I have for y'all. So this brings me to like a little conclusion section and just wrapping up some admin-y things. I got a suggestion, not I got a suggestion. I got some feedback that somewhat that my so in my first couple of episodes, I did the did kind of a table of contents of annotations at the beginning of each episode with a link to the minute and second that a section of the segment of the podcast would begin. And someone told me that they found that really useful. I would be happy to do that. I'm not sure I'll have the time to do it for this episode, but I will definitely try to continue it in future episodes. So I also someone also replied to a comment I made last episode. I asked if it was okay that I was showing just photos of FOs in a slideshow because I had given them away, or you know, if it was a commission, I had already given it to the recipient and just showed pictures of them wearing it. So I got an okay for that. If anyone would like to disagree, feel free to, and please let me know your thoughts. But yeah, I'm very open to suggestions for what I can do to just make this viewing experience better. I know I'm pretty amateur at editing videos and stuff. But anyway, add one more admin-y thing. Because I am going to be moving to New Jersey, but in between, I'm going to be. So, right after graduation, I'm going on a trip to Yosemite with some friends for a few days. And then after that, I'm going to be home in Las Vegas for a couple weeks. I don't know how easy it will be for me to sit down and record and podcast in these next few weeks. So I'm just gonna tell you, please don't expect a consistent schedule for me until I am nicely moved in and settled into wherever my place will be in New Jersey. So thank you for your patience. Thank you for tuning in. And if you are a new viewer, thanks for checking me out. I hope you liked it, but if not, that's okay. There are lots of really cool podcasts out there, and I'm sure you'll find something you like. If you're a returning viewer, thanks so much for your continuing support, and thank you for walking with me on this path. And I hope you're as excited as I am for what changes will be in the near future. All right. I'll see you when I see you, and have a great rest of your day. Hope you get some time to yourself, which will hopefully include knitting or crafting or just creative time. Bye.
First thing I have to show is.